Throughout the world, throngs of people hail the end of the war in Europe. It is 5 years and more since Hitler marched into Poland. Years full of suffering and death and sacrifice. Now the war against Germany is won. A grateful nation gives thanks for victory. Hundreds of thousands crowd into American churches to give thanks to God. President Truman announced the official surrender.
This is a solemn but glorious hour. I wish that Franklin D. Roosevelt had lived to see this day. General Eisenhower informs me that the forces of Germany have surrendered to the United Nations. The flags of freedom fly all over Europe. For this victory, we join in offering our thanks to the Providence which has guided and sustained us through the dark days of adversity and into light. Much remains to be done. The victory won in the West must now be won in the East. The whole world must be cleansed of the evil from which half the world has been freed. United, the peace-loving nations have demonstrated in the West that their arms are stronger by far than the might of dictators or the tyranny of military cliques that once called us soft and weak. The power of our peoples to defend themselves against all enemies will be proved in the Pacific War as it was proved in Europe.
Historic pictures of the last days of the war in Europe show American and Russian troops as they joined at Torgau on the River Elbe, splitting German armies in two. United States General Reinhardt meets Red Army General Rusakoff, a meeting that spelled out certain German defeat. At Allied Mediterranean headquarters in Italy, the Germans unconditionally give up all of Italy and southern Austria. In civilian clothes, representatives of the German armies sign the surrender document. General W.D. Morgan, representing Supreme Mediterranean Commander Alexander, signs for the Allies. Preceding the final capitulation at Reims, this surrender eliminated 1 million German troops. Inside Germany itself, the Allies seize the famous Stadium of Nuremberg, scene of countless Nazi party rallies. With the capture of this famous southern German city, the American flag blouts out the swastika. In a symbolic gesture, American troops destroy the Nazi party emblem.
Inside the White House, the last hour of the last day of World War II. Here and across the nation, tense crowds await the end. Inside, newsmen are summoned to the president's office to see history made.
I deem this reply a full acceptance of the Potsdam Declaration, which specifies the unconditional surrender of Japan. In the reply, there is no qualification. Arrangements are now being made for the formal signing of the surrender terms at the earliest possible moment. General Douglas MacArthur has been appointed the Supreme Allied Commander to receive the Japanese surrender. The proclamation of VJ Day must wait until the formal signing of the surrender terms by Japan.
Reporters make a dash for official handouts. Within a matter of minutes, the historic news is flashed to every country on the globe. Meanwhile, New York crowds have been waiting day and night for word from Washington. It is 2 minutes after 7. Nerves keyed to the breaking point by last-minute Jap stalling, by rumors and denials that surrender is on its way. Then the news hits Times Square. All the pent-up joy of 5 days waiting is unleashed. New York and Main Street everywhere pulls out the stops and lets go. Yes, from coast to coast, victory gets a spontaneous welcome. San Francisco, blacked out and constantly alerted against Jap treachery, uncorks the pent-up emotions of almost 4 years. Market Street is a madhouse, but who cares on BJ Day? In Seattle, Boeing workers, builders of those giant B-29s, take some time off at last. Downtown at 4th and Pike Streets, they see sailors lift automobiles, soldiers kiss pretty girls, a little trouble, but only a little. Then the Navy takes up the girl-kissing detail and the carrying off of beautiful maidens. A marathon celebration as happy war-working Seattle roars its tribute to victory. The Midwest gives voice, too. At State and Madison, joy is really breaking out all over. And the jam-packed loop keeps it up all night. Down south in Atlanta, it's the same story. All of North Georgia tries to squeeze into Peachtree Street, as people did in every town in every state. But BJ Day has a grim side, too. Wounded vets at Atlanta's Lawson General Hospital hear the news. These men know the true price of victory. For them, the war will never end, never quite. But back in New York, Chinatown casts aside its usual quiet dignity. Ritualistic dragons, symbols of peace, cavort along Pell and Mott streets. Happy end to 8 bitter years of Jap aggression. In nearby Mulberry Street, Little Italy makes with the noise and dancing in the street, a colorful corner of the big town celebration. But it's at Times Square New York really lets go. 2 million people jammed into 10 blocks. And listen. The Great White Way is itself once more, only more so. And this joyous din keeps up all night. But comes the dawn, and even blasé New York seems to have exhausted itself. But wake up there, son. This war was big enough for 2 celebrations. And sure enough, the entire show starts all over again by daylight. The kissing, the impromptu entertainment. The biggest, noisiest celebration in New York's history. 2 days of needed popping off before we face the realities of peace in a world which contains a new cosmic force, the atomic bomb.
I learn in this letter that Don Pedro, the general, comes this very night to Messina.
He is very near by this. He was not 3 leagues off when I left him.
How many men have you lost in this action?
Few of any sort, and none of name.
At victory, it's twice itself when a victor brings home full numbers. I read here that Don Pedro has bestowed much honor on a young Florentine named Claudio.
Much deserved on his part and equally remembered by Don Pedro. He hath borne himself beyond the promise of his age, doing in the figure of a lamb the feats of a lion.
I pray you, is Signor Mountanto returned from the wars, or no?
I know none of that name, lady. There was none in the army of any sort.
Was he you asked for, niece?
My cousin means Signor Benedick from Padua.
Good.
Oh, he's returned, and as pleasant as he ever was.
I pray you, how many hath he killed and eaten in these wars? But how many hath he killed? For indeed I promise to eat all of his killing.
Faith, niece, you tax Signor Benedick too much. But I'm certain he'll meet with you, I no doubt.
He hath done good service, lady, in these wars.
You have musty victual, and he hath holp to eat it. He's a very valiant trencherman. He hath an excellent stomach.
And a good soldier, too, lady.
And a good soldier, too, a lady. But what is he to a lord?
Lord to a lord, a man to a man, stuffed with all honorable virtues.
It is indeed. He is no less than a stuffed man.
Will you never run mad, niece?
No, uncle. And I'm sure you may say that there's a war between me and Benedick, but...
You must not mistake, ma'am, my niece. There's a merry war between Signor Benedict and her. There's a skirmish wit, even though they have not met. They've never met.
But I pray you, who is his companion now? He hath every month a new sworn brother.
Is it possible?
Very easily possible. He wears his faith as in the fashion of his hat. It ever changes with the next block.
I see, lady, the gentleman is not in your books.
No, and he were, I would burn my study.
You will never run mad, niece.
No, uncle, I won't. But who is his companion? Is there no young squarer that will make a voyage to the devil?
He's most in the company of the right noble Claudio.
Poor man. He will hang upon him like a disease. He's sooner caught than the pestilence, and the taker runs presently mad. God, help the noble Claudio. If he have caught the Benedick, it will take him 1,000 pounds ere he be cured.
I will hold friends with you, lady.
Do, good friend. And no, uncle, I won't run mad, not till a hot January.
Oh, Don Pedro has approached.
Good Signor Leonato. You are come to meet your trouble. The fashion of the world is to avoid cost, and you encounter it.
Never came trouble to the like this my house, upon your grace. For trouble being gone, comfort should remain. But when you depart from me, sorrow abides and happiness takes its leave.
You embrace your charge too willingly. I think this is your daughter?
Her mother hath many times told me so.
Were you in doubt, sir, that you asked her?
Signor Benedict, no, for then you were a child.
Truly, the lady fathers herself. Be happy, lady, for you are like an honorable father.
If Signor Leonato be her father, she would not have his head on her shoulders for all Messina, as like him as she is.
I wonder that you will still be talking, Signor Benedict. Nobody marks you.
What, my dear Lady Disdain? Are you yet living?
Is it possible Disdain should die while she has such meat food to feed it as Signor Benedick? Courtesy itself must convert to disdain if you come in her presence.
Then is courtesy a turncoat? But it is certain I am loved of all ladies, only you excepted. And I would, I could, find in my heart that I had not a hard heart, for truly I love none.
A dear happiness to women, else they'd be troubled by a pernicious suitor. I thank God in my cold blood I'm of your humor for that. I would rather hear a dog bark at a crow than a man swear he loves me.
God keep your ladyship still in that mind, so some gentleman or other may escape a predestinate scratched face.
Scratching would not make it worse, and for such a face as yours were.
Well, you are a rare parrot teacher.
A bird of my tongue is better than a beast of yours.
I would my horse of the speed of your tongue, and so good a continuer. But keep your way, I have done.
You always end with a jade's trick. I know you of old.
That is the sum of all, Leonato. Signor Benedick, Signor Claudio, my dear friend Leonato here hath invited you all. I tell him we shall stay here at least a month, and he heartily prays some occasion may detain us longer.
Don Pedro, let me bid you welcome. Being reconciled to the prince, your brother, I owe you all duty.
Don John, and I thank you. I am not of many words, but I thank you.
Well, please it lead on, your grace.
Your hand, Leonato, we'll go together.
Signor Benedick, didst thou note the daughter of Signor Leonato?
I looked on her, but I noted her not.
Is she not a modest young lady?
Would you have me speak after my custom as being a professed tyrant to their sex?
No, I pray thee, speak in sober judgment.
Why, in faith, methinks she too low for a high praise, too brown for a fair praise, and too little for a great praise. Only this commendation can I afford her, that she were, other than she is, she were unhandsome. And being no other than she is, I do not like her.
Thou thinkest I am in sport? No, I pray thee, tell me how thou likest her.
Would you buy her that you inquire after her?
Can the world buy such a jewel?
Yes, in a case to put it in. But speak you this with a sad brow?
In mine eyes, she is the sweetest lady I ever looked upon.
I can see yet without spectacles, and I see no such matter. There's her cousin, and were she not possessed with a fury, exceeds her as well in beauty as the first of May doth the last of December. But I hope you have no intent to turn husband. Do you?
I would scarce trust myself, though I had sworn the contrary if Hero would be my wife.
Just come to this? Shall I never see a bachelor of 80 again? Go to, in faith, and thy will needs thrust thy neck into a yoke, wear the print of it, and sigh away Sundays. Look, Don Pedro has returned to seek you. Oh.
What secret hath held you here that you fall not to Leonardo's?
I would your grace would constrain me to tell.
I charge thee on thy allegiance.
On my allegiance, mark you this, on my allegiance, he is in love. With who? Now that is your grace's part. Mark you how short his answer is. With Hero, Leonardo's short daughter.
Amen if you love her, for the lady is very well worthy.
You speak this to fetch me in, my lord?
By my troth, I spoke my thought.
And in faith, I spoke mine.
And by my two troths and faith, my lord, I spoke mine.
That I love her, I feel.
That she is worthy, I know.
That I neither feel how she should be loved, nor how she should be worthy. It's the opinion that fire cannot melt out of me. I shall die in it in the stake.
Oh, thou was ever an obstinate heretic in the despite of beauty.
That a woman conceived me, I thank her. That she brought me up, I likewise give her most humble thanks. But I will not do them the wrong to mistrust any. I'll do myself the right to trust none. And the fine is, for which I may go the finer, I will live a bachelor.
Oh, I shall see thee ere I die, look pale with love.
In anger, in sickness, or in hunger, my lord, but not with love.
Well, as time shall try, in time the savage bull doth bear the yoke.
Well, the savage bull may, but if ever the sensible Benedick bear it, pluck out the bull's horns and set them in my forehead, and let me be vilely painted, and in such great letters as they write, here you may see good horse for hire, let them signify under my sign, here you may see Benedick, the married man.
Nay, if Cupid have not spent all his quiver in Venice, thou wilt quake for this shortly.
Mm. I look for an earthquake too, then.
Hath Leonardo any son, my lord?
No child but Hero. She's his only heir. Dost thou affect her, Claudio?
Oh, my lord. When I went on this ended action, I looked upon her with a soldier's eye that liked but had rougher task on hand than to drive liking to the name of love. Now I'm returned, and those war thoughts have left their places vacant. And in their places came soft, thronging, and delicate desires, all prompting to how fair young Hero is, saying, I liked her here ere I went to wars.
Thou wilt be like a lover presently, and tire the hearer with a book of words. If thou dost love fair Hero, cherish it. and I will break with her and with her father, and thou shalt have her. I know we shall have reveling tonight. I will assume thy part in some disguise and tell fair hero I am Claudio. And in her bosom I'll unclasp my heart and take her hearing prisoner with the force and strong encounter of my amorous tale. Then after to her father I will break, and the conclusion is she shall be thine.
Good year, my lord. Why are you thus at a measure sad?
There is no measure in the occasion that breeds. Therefore, the sadness is without limit.
You should hear reason.
And when I have heard it, what blessing brings it?
If not a present remedy, at least a patient sufferance.
I cannot hide what I am. I must be sad when I have cause and smile at no man's jests. Eat when I have stomach and wait for no man's leisure. Sleep when I am drowsy and tend on no man's business. Laugh when I am merry, and claw no man in his humor.
Yea, but you must not make full show of it till you may do it without controlment. You have of late stood out against your brother, and he hath taken you newly into his grace, where it is impossible that you should take true root, but by the fair weather you make yourself. It is needful that you frame the season for your own harvest.
I'd rather be a canker in a hedge than a rose in his grace. And it better fits my blood to be disdained of all than to fashion a carriage to rob love from any. In this, though I cannot be said to be a flattering, honest man, it must not be denied, but I am a plain-dealing villain. I am trusted with a muzzle and enfranchised with a clog. Therefore, I have decreed not to sing in my cage. If I had my mouth, I would bite. If I had my liberty, I would do my liking. In the meantime, let me be that I am, and seek not to alter me.
Can you make no use of your discontent?
I make all use of it, for I use it only. Who comes here? What news, Borachio?
I've come yonder from a great supper. The prince, your brother, is royally entertained by Leonato, and I bear intelligence of an intended marriage.
Will it serve for any model to build mischief on? What is he for a fool that betroths himself to unquietness?
Mary, it is your brother's right hand.
Who, the most exquisite Claudio?
Even he.
A proper squire. And who? And who? Which way looks he?
He looks towards Hero, the sole daughter and heir to Leonato.
A very forward march chick. How came you to this?
I heard it agreed upon that the prince should woo Hero for himself, and, having obtained her, give her over to Count Claudio.
Come. Come, let us thither. This may prove food to my displeasure. That young startup hath all the glory of my overthrow. If I can cross him any way, I bless myself every way. You are both sure and will assist me.
To the death, my lord.
Was Don John not here at supper?
I saw him not, but how tartly that gentleman looks. I can hardly see him, but am heartburned an hour after.
He is of a very melancholy disposition.
He were the perfect man that were made in the midway between him and Benedick. One is too much like an image and says nothing, and the other too much like my lady's eldest son, evermore tattling.
By my troth, niece, you'll never get thee a husband if you're so shrewd of thy tongue.
For which blessing I am on my knees every night and morning. I cannot endure a husband with a beard on his face.
You have on husband that hath no beard?
And what would I do with him? Dress him in my apparel and make him my waiting gentlewoman? He that hath a beard is more than a youth. And he that hath no beard is less than a man. And he that is more than a youth is not for me. and he that is less than a man, I am not for him.
Well, daughter, I hope you'll be ruled by your father.
Yes, faith, it is my cousin's duty to make curtsy and say father as it please you. But for all that, cousin, let him be a handsome fellow, or else make another curtsy and say father as it please me.
Well, niece, I hope to see you one day fitted with a husband.
Not till God make men out of some other metal than earth. Would it not grieve a woman to be overmastered by a valiant piece of dust? To make an account of her life to a clod of wayward marl? No, uncle, all none. Adam's sons are my kindred. And truly, I consider it a sin to match in my brethren.
Well, daughter, if the prince do solicit you in that kind, do you know your answer?
Yes. If you be not wooed in good time, the fault will be in the music, cousin. If the prince think himself too important, tell him there is measure in everything, and so dance out the answer.
Make good room. The revelers are entering.
Well, I would that you did like me.
Well, I would that you didn't, for I have many ill qualities.
Which is one?
I say my prayers aloud.
I wish to love you all the more. May the heralds cry. Amen.
God match me with a good dancer.
Amen.
Will you not tell me who told you so?
No, you shall pardon me.
Nor will you tell me who you are?
No, not now.
That I was disdainful, that I had my wit out of the hundred merry tales. This was Signor Benedick that said so.
Oi, who's he?
I'm sure you know him well enough.
Not I, believe me.
Did he never make you laugh?
Tell me, who is he?
He is the prince's jester, a dull fool. His only gift is in devising impossible slanders, and none but libertines delight in him. And the commendation is not in his wit, but in his villainy, which both pleases men and angers them, and then they laugh at him and beat him.
When I meet this German, I'll tell him what you say.
Do. He'll but break a comparison or two on me, which, peradventure not laughed at, strikes him into a melancholy. And then there's a partridge wing saved, for the fool will eat no supper that night. We must follow the leaders.
In every good thing.
Nay, if they lead to any ill, I'll leave them at the next tourney. Woo!
Thank you.
lady, will you walk about with a friend?
Sure, my brother is amorous on Hero and hath withdrawn her father to break with him about it. The ladies follow her, and but one visor remains.
Hey, that's Claudio. I know him by his bearing.
Are you not Signor Benedick?
You know me well. I am he.
Signor, you are very near my brother in his love. He is enamored on Hero. I pray you, dissuade him from her. She's no equal of his birth. You'll do the part of an honest man in it.
How know you he loves her?
Oh, I heard him swear his affection.
So did I, too. And he swore he would marry her tonight.
Come, let's to the banquet.
Thus answer I in the name of Benedick. But hear these ill news with the ears of Claudio. 'Tis certain so. The prince woos for himself. Friendship is constant in all other things, save in the office and affairs of love. Therefore, let every heart in love use their own tongue. Let every eye negotiate for itself. And trust no agent, for beauty is a witch, against whose grace's faith melteth into blood. Claudio. Yes, the same.
Will you go with me? The prince hath got your Hero.
I wish him joy of her.
Did you think the prince would have served you thus?
I pray you, leave me!
Oh, now you strike like the blind man? 'Twas the boy that stole your meat, but you'll beat the post.
If it will not be, then I leave you.
Alas, poor hurt fowl. Now will he creep into sedges. But that my lady Beatrice should know me and not know me. The prince's jester. Huh? It may be that I go under that title because I am merry. Yea, but so I am apt to do myself wrong? I am not so reputed. It is the base, though bitter, disposition of Beatrice that places the world into her person and so gives me out. Well, I'll be revenged as I may.
Now, senor, where's the count? Did you see him?
Troth, my lord. I found him here as melancholy as a lodge in Warren. I told him, and I think I told him true, that your grace had only got the goodwill of his young lady.
The lady Beatrice hath a quarrel to you. The man that danced with her told her that she is much wronged by you.
Oh, she misuses me past the endurance of a block. She told me, not thinking I was myself, that I was the prince's jester, that I was duller than a great thaw, huddling jest upon jest with such impossible conveyance that I stood like a man at a mark, with the whole army shooting at me. She speaks poignards, and every word stabs. If her breath were as terrible as her terminations, there'd be no living near her. She would infect to the North Star. I would not marry her, though she were endowed with all that Adam had left him before he transgressed. I would, some scholar would, conjure her, for certainly while she was still here, all disquiet, horror, and perturbations follow her.
Oh, look, here she comes.
Will your grace do me any service, send me on any service to the world's end? I will go now on the slightest errand to the Antipodes that you can advise to send me on. I will. Fetch you a toothpick from the furthest inches of Asia. Bring you a hair off the great Cam's beard. Do you any ambassage to the pygmies? Rather than hold 3 words conference with this harpy.
Oh.
Lord, have you no employment for me?
None but to desire your good company.
Oh, good sir. Here's a dish I love not. I cannot endure my lady tongue.
Oh, come, lady, come. You have lost the heart of Signor Benedick.
He lent it me once, and I gave him use for it. A double heart for his single one. Mary, once before, he won it off me with false dice. Therefore, you may well say, I have lost it.
You have put him down, lady. You have put him down.
So would I not he should do to me, my lord, lest I should prove to be the mother of fools. I have brought Count Claudio, whom you sent me to seek.
How now, Count? Wherefore are you sad?
Not sad, my lord.
How then, sick?
Neither, my lord.
The Count is neither sad, nor sick, nor merry, nor well. But civil, Count. Civil as an orange, and something of that jealous complexion.
In faith, lady, I think your blazon be true. Though if he be so, his conceit is false. Here, Claudio, I have wooed in thy name. I have broke with her father and his good will obtained. Name the day of marriage, and God give thee joy.
Come, Count, take my daughter and with her my fortunes. His grace has made the match, and I say amen to it.
Speak, Count. 'Tis your cue.
Silence is the perfectest herald of joy. I were but little happy if I could say as much. Lady, as you are mine, I'm yours. I give myself away to you and dote upon this exchange.
Speak, cousin. Or, if you cannot speak, stop his mouth with a kiss and let him speak neither.
Oh, in faith, lady, you have a merry heart.
Yes, poor fool, I thank it. It keeps on the windy side of care. My cousin tells him in his ear that he is in her heart.
And so she does, cousin.
Thank goodness for alliance. Thus everyone goes into the world but I, and I am sunburnt. I may sit in a corner and cry, hi-ho for a husband.
Lady Beatrice, I will get you one.
Have you one of your father's getting? Or hath your grace ne'er a brother like you? Your father got excellent husbands if a maid could come by them.
Oh. Well, would you have me, lady?
No, my grace, your grace. Unless, I might have another for working days, too. Your grace is too costly to wear every day. But I beseech you, pardon me. I was born to speak all mirth and no matter.
Your silence most offends me, but to be merry best becomes you, for out of question you were born in a merry hour.
No, sure, my mother cried. But then a star danced, and under that I was born. Cousins, God give you joy.
By my troth, pleasant-spirited lady.
There's little of the melancholy element in her, my lord. She's never sad except when she sleeps. My daughter hath many times told me so. She's woke herself with laughing.
She cannot endure to hear tell of a husband.
Oh, by no means. She mocks her roars out of suit.
She were an excellent wife for Benedick.
Oh, lord, my lord. If they were a week married, they would talk themselves mad.
Count Claudio, when mean you to go to church?
Tomorrow, my lord. Time goes on crutches till love have all his rights.
Not till Monday, my dear son, which is hence a seventh night, the time too soon to speak my mind.
Oh, come, why shake you the head at so long a breathing? I warrant thee, Claudio, the time shall not go dully by us, for I will, in the interim, undertake one of Hercules' labors, which is to bring the Lady Beatrice and the Senior Benedick into a mountain of affection, the one with the other. I would fain have it a match, and I doubt not but to fashion it, if you three will minister such assistance.
I am with you, my lord. but it cost me 10 nights' watchings.
And I, my lord.
And you too, gentle hero?
I will do any modest office, my lord, to help my cousin to a good husband.
Benedick is not the unhopefulest husband that I know. Thus far can I praise him. He is of noble strain, of approved valor, and confirmed honesty. I will teach you how to humor your cousin that she shall fall in love with Benedick. And I, with your two helps, will so practice on Benedick that despite of his quick wit and his queasy stomach, he shall fall in love with Beatrice. If we can do this, Cupid is no longer an archer. His glory shall be ours, for we are the only love gods. Go in with me, and I will tell you my drift.
It is so. The Count Claudio shall marry the daughter of Leonato.
Yea, but I can cross it.
Any bar, any cross, any impediment will be medicinable to me. I am sick in displeasure to him, and whatsoever comes athwart his affection ranges evenly with mine. How canst thou thwart this marriage?
I have told your lordship a year since how I am in favor with Margaret, the waiting lady to hero.
I remember.
I could, at any seasonable instant of the night, appoint her to look out her lady's chamber window.
What life is in that to be the death of this marriage?
Ah, the poison in that lies in you to temper. Go you to the prince your brother. Tell him he hath wronged his honor in marrying the renowned Claudio, whose estimation do you mightily hold up, but to a contaminated stale, such a one as hero.
What proof shall I make of that?
Proof enough to misuse the prince, to vex Claudio, to shame hero, and kill Leonato. Look you for any other issue?
Only to despite them, I will endeavor anything.
Good. Go then. Find me a meet hour to draw Don Pedro and the Count Claudio alone. Tell them that you know that hero loves me. Intend a sort of zeal, for both in love of the prince your brother's honor, who hath made this match, and his friend's reputation, who should like to be cozened with the semblance of a maid that you have discovered thus. They will scarcely believe you without trial, so therefore offer them instances, which shall bear no less than to see me outside her chamber window, hear me term Margaret hero, hear Margaret term me Claudio, and take them to see this the very night before the wedding. In the meantime, I will structure it so that hero will be absent from this whole encounter. And there, after seeing such seeming truths, jealousy will be called assurance, and all preparations overthrown.
Grow you to what adverse issue it can. I will put it in practice. Be cunning in the working this, and thy fee is 1,000 ducats.
Be you constant in your accusation, and my cunning will not fail me.
I will presently go learn their day of marriage.
I do much wonder that one man, seeing how much another man is a fool, when he dedicates his behaviors to love, will, after having laughed at such shallow follies in others, become the argument of his own scorn by falling in love. And such a man is Claudio. I have known when there is no music in him but the drum and the fife. Now, would he rather hear the tabor and the pipe? I have known him when he would have walked 10 miles afoot to see a good armor. Now, will he lie 10 nights awake, carving the fashions of a new doublet? He was wont to speak plainly and to the purpose, like an honest man and a soldier. Now he has turned orthography. His words are a very fantastical banquet. So many strange dishes. May I be so converted and see with these eyes? I cannot tell. I think not. I will not be sworn, but that love may transform me to an oyster. But I'll take my oath on it. Till he hath made an oyster of me, he shall never make me such a fool. One woman is fair, yet I am well. Another is wise, yet I am well. Another is virtuous, yet I am well. But till all graces be in one woman shall not come in my grace. Rich she shall be, that's certain. Wise, or I'll none. Virtuous, or I'll never cheapen her. Fair, I'll never look on her. Mild, or come not near me. Noble, or not I for an angel. Of good discourse, an excellent musician. And her hair shall be of whatever color it pleases God. Here comes the prince and Monsieur Love. I shall hide me.
Come hither, Leonato. What was it you told me of today? That your niece Beatrice is in love with Senior Benedick?
Oh, aye, stock on. The foul sits. I did never think that lady would have loved any man.
No, nor I neither. Most wonderful that she is should dote on Senior Benedict? And who on all outward behavior she seemed to abhor?
'Tis possible. Sits the wind in that corner.
By my troth, my lord, I cannot tell what to think of it, but that she loves him with an enraged affection, 'tis past infinite thought.
You amaze me. How would have I thought her spirit invincible against all assaults of affection?
And I, my lord, especially against Senior Benedict.
Has she made her affection known to Benedict?
No, and she swears she never will. That's her torment.
'Tis certain so. So your daughter says, shall I, says she, that so often countered him with scorn, write to him that I love him?
Oh, by no means. She mocks herself that she would write to one that would be so immodest to her. She says, by my own spirit, I should measure him. Though I love him, if he would write to me, I should mock him. So if I love him, I should.
Then down upon her knees she falls, weeps, sobs, beats her heart, tears her hair, prays, curses. Oh, sweet Benedict. God, give me patience.
I would have thought, I wish she had bestowed this dotage upon me.
We're good, you think?
Well, Hero says she will surely die ere she make her love known, and she will die if he love her not, and she will die if he woo her. Rather, she will bate one breath of her accustomed crossness.
She doth well, if she should make tender of her love. 'Tis possible he'll scorn it, for the man, as you know all, hath a contemptible spirit.
He is a very proper man.
He hath indeed a good outward happiness.
And by God, and in my mind, very wise.
He doth show some sparks that are like wit.
And I do take him to be valiant.
Well, I'm sorry for your niece. Shall we go seek Benedick and tell him of her love?
Never tell him, my lord. Let her wear it out with good counsel.
No! She may wear her heart out first.
Well, we'll hear further of it by your daughter. I love Benedick well, and I could wish he would modestly examine himself to see how unworthy he is of so good a lady.
Well, my lord, will you walk? Supper is ready.
Can be no trick. The conference was sadly born. They have the truth of this from Hero. Love me. Why? It must be requited. I hear how I am censored. They say I will bear myself proudly if I perceive the love come from her. They say, too, that she would rather die than show any sign of affection. I did never think to marry. I must not seem proud. Happy are they that can hear their detractions and put them to mending. They say the lady is fair. 'Tis a truth. I can bear them witness. And virtuous, 'tis so, I cannot reprove it. And wise? Oh, but for loving me. By my troth, that is no addition to her wit, nor no great argument of her folly, for I shall be horribly in love with her! I may chance have some odd quirks and remnants of wit broken on me because I have railed so long against marriage, but doth not the appetite alter? The man loves the meat in his youth that he cannot endure in his age. Shall these quips and sentences and paper bullets of the brain awe a man from the career of his humor? No. The world must be peopled. When I said I would die a bachelor, I did not think that I would live till I were married. Oh, here comes Beatrice now. By this day, she is a fair lady. I do spy some marks of love in her.
Against my will, I am sent to bid you to come to dinner.
Fair Beatrice, I thank you for your pains.
I took no more pain for those thanks than you would take pain to thank me. If it were painful, I would not have come.
You take pleasure, then, in the message?
Yay. Just so much as you would take upon a knife's point. You have no stomach, Signor. Fare you well.
Against my will, I am sent to bid thee come to dinner. Double meaning in that! I took no more pains for those thanks than you took pains to thank me. Well, that's as much to say that any pains that I take for you are as much as thanks. If I do not pity her, I am a villain. And if I do not love her, I am a fool. I will go get her picture.
Margaret, run thee to the parlor. There shalt thou find my cousin Beatrice proposing with the prince and Claudio. Whisper her ear and tell her I and Ursula walk in the orchard and our whole discourse is all of her. Say that thou overheardst us and bid her steal into the pleached bower. There will she hide her to listen our purpose. This is thy office. Bear thee well in it and leave us alone.
I'll make her come.
Now, Ursula. When Beatrice doth come, as we do trace this alley up and down, our whole talk must be only of Benedick. When I do name him, let it be thy part to praise him more than ever man did merit. My talk to thee must be how Benedick is sick in love with Beatrice. Of this little matter is Cupid's crafty arrow made that only wounds by hearsay. Now begin, for look, where Beatrice like a lapwing runs close by the ground to your conference. No, truly, Ursula, she's too disdainful. I know her spirits are as coy and wild as haggards of the rock.
But are you sure? Benedick loves Beatrice so entirely.
So says the prince and my new trothed lord.
And did they bid you tell her of it, madam?
They did entreat me to acquaint her of it, but I persuaded them, if they love Benedick, to wish him wrestle with affection and never to let Beatrice know of it.
Why did you so? Doth not the gentleman deserve as full and fortunate a bed as ever Beatrice should couch upon?
Oh, Ursula, I know he doth deserve as much as may be yielded to any man, but nature never framed a woman's heart of prouder stuff than that of Beatrice. Disdain and scorn ride sparkling in her eyes, misprizing what they look on. And her wit values itself so highly that to her, all matter else seems weak. She cannot love, nor take no shape, nor project of affection. She is so self-endeared.
Sure, I think so. Therefore, it were not good she know his love, lest she make sport of it.
Why, you speak truth. I never yet saw a man how wise, how noble, young, how rarely featured. But she would spell him backward. If fair-faced, she would swear the gentleman should be her sister. If dark, why, nature, drawing of an antique, made a foul blot. If tall, a lance ill-headed. If low, an agate very vilely cut. If speaking, why, a vein blown with all winds. If silent, a block moved with none. So turns she every man the wrong side out, and never gives way to truth that which simpleness and merit purchaseth.
Sure. Such carping is not commendable.
No, not to be so odd and from all fashions as Beatrice is cannot be commendable. But who dare tell her so? If I should speak, oh, she would mock me into air, she would laugh me out of myself, press me to death with wit. Therefore, let Benedick, like covered fire, consume away in sighs, waste inwardly. It were a better death than die with mocks, which is as bad as die with tickling.
Yet, tell her of it. Hear what she would say.
No, rather, I'll go to Benedick and counsel him to fight against his passion. And truly, I'll devise some honest slanders to stain my cousin with. One doth not know how much an ill word may empoison liking.
Do not do your cousin such a wrong. She cannot be so much without true judgment, having such a swift and excellent wit as she's prized to have, to refuse such a rare gentleman as Signor Benedick.
He is the only man of Italy. Always excepting my dear Claudio.
When are you married, madam?
Why, every day tomorrow. Come, go in. I'll show thee some attires and have thy counsel which is the best to furnish me tomorrow.
She is limed, I warrant you. We have caught her, madam.
If it proves so, then loving goes by haps. Some Cupid kills with arrows, some with traps.
What fire is in mine ears? Can this be true? Stand I condemned for pride and scorn so much? Contempt? Farewell. Maiden pride, adieu. No glory lives behind the back of such. And Benedick, love on. I will requite thee, taming my wild heart to thy loving hand. If thou dost incite thee, we can bind our loves up in a holy band. For others say thou dost deserve, and I believe it better than reportingly.
Oh, I do, but stay till your marriage be consummate, and then go I toward Aragon.
I'll bring you to them, my lord, if you'll vouchsafe for me.
No, that would be as great a soil on the new gloss of your marriage as to show a child their new coat and forbid him to wear it. Nay, I will only be bold with Benedick for his company, for from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet, he is all mirth. He hath twice or thrice caught Cupid's bowstring, and the little hangman dare not shoot at him. He has a heart as sound as a bell, and his tongue is the clapper. For what his heart thinks, his tongue speaks.
Oh, gallants, I am not as I have been.
So say I. Methinks you are sadder.
I hope he be in love.
Oh, hang him, truant. There be no true drop of blood in him to be truly touched by love. If he be sad, he wants money.
I have the toothache.
Oh, what? Sigh for the toothache.
Well, everyone can master a grief but he that has it.
If he be not in love with some lady, There's no denying old signs.
Oh. Hath any man seen him at the barber's?
No, but the barber man hath been seen with him.
Nay, he rubs himself with civet. Can you smell him out by that?
That's as much to say. The sweet youth's in love.
Aww. The greatest note of it is his melancholy.
And when was he wont to wash his face?
Oh, indeed. That tells a heavy tale for him. Conclude? Conclude he is in love.
Nay, but I know who loves him.
Oh, that I would know too, I warrant. Someone who knows him not.
Yet is this no sigh for the toothache? Old senor, walk with me. I have studied 8 or 9 wise words that I would speak with you, which these hobby horses must not hear. Come.
For my life to break with him about Beatrice.
Both Hero and Margaret have played their parts with Beatrice. Now the two bears will not bite one another once they meet.
My lord and brother, God save you.
Good den, brother.
If your leisure served, I would speak with you.
In private?
If it please you. Yet Count Claudio may hear, for what I would speak of concerns him.
Why? What's the matter?
Means your lordship to be married tomorrow night?
You know he does.
I know not that when he knows what I know.
If there be any impediment, I pray you discover it.
You may think I love you not. Let that appear hereafter, and aim better at me by that I now will manifest.
Why? What's the matter?
The lady is disloyal.
Who? Hero?
Even she. Leonato's hero, your hero, every man's hero.
Disloyal!
The word is too good to paint out her wickedness. I could say she were worse. Think of a worse title, I will fit her to it. Wonder not till further warrant. Go but with me tonight. You will see her chamber window entered even the night before her wedding day. If you love her then, tomorrow marry her. But it would better suit your honor to change your mind.
May this be so?
I will not think it.
If you will follow me, I will show you enough. And when you have seen more and heard more, proceed accordingly.
If I see anything tonight, why should not marry her? Tomorrow, in the congregation where I wed, there I will shame her.
And as I wooed for thee to obtain her, I will join with thee to disgrace her.
I will disparage her no farther till you both are my witnesses. Bear it coldly but till midnight, and let the issue show itself.
Thank you. Are you good men and true?
Yea, or else it were by pity they should suffer salvation body and soul.
Nay, that's where a punishment too good for them, if they should have any allegiance in them, being chosen for the prince's watch.
Well, give them their charge, neighbor Dogberry.
First, who think you the most desertless man to be constable?
Hugh Oatcake, sir, or George Seacole, for they can write and read.
Hmm. Come, neighbor Seacole. You are thought here to be the most senseless and fit man for the constable of the watch. Therefore, bury the lantern. This is your charge. You are to comprehend all vagrant men. You are to bid any man stand in the prince's name.
How, if he will not stand?
Why then, take no note of him, and let him go, and presently call the rest of the watch together, and thank goodness you're rid of a knave.
If he will not stand when he is bidden, he is none of the prince's subjects.
True, and they are to meddle with none but the prince's subjects. You are to also make no noise in the streets, for the watch to talk and to babble is most tolerable, and not to be endured.
We would rather sleep than talk. You know what belongs to a watch.
Hmm. Well, you're to call at all the alehouses and bid those that are drunk get them to bed.
How if they will not?
Why then, let them alone until they are sober. If they make you not the better answer, you may say they are not the men you took them for.
Well, sir?
If you meet a thief, you may suspect him. By virtue of your office, to be no true man, the less you meddle and make with them, why then, the more is for your honesty.
If we know him to be a thief, shall we not lay hands on him?
Truly, by your office, you may. But I think those that touch pitch will be defiled. The most peaceful way for you, if you do take a thief, is to let him show himself what he is and steal out of your company.
Oh, you have always been called a merciful man, partner.
Truly, I would not hang a dog by my will, much less a man who hath any honesty in him.
Oh, if you hear a child cry in the night, you must call to the nurse and bid her still it.
How if the nurse be asleep and will not hear us?
Why then, depart in peace and let the child awake her with crying. This is the end of your charge. You, constable, are to present the prince's own person. If you meet the prince in the night, you may stay him.
Nay, by Our Lady, that I think he cannot.
Mary, not without the prince be willing, for the watch ought to offend no man, and it is a defense to stay a man against his will.
By Our Lady, I think it be so.
Well, masters, if there be any matter of weight chances, call me. Keep your fellow counsels and your own. And good night. Come, neighbor.
Well, masters, we hear our charge. Let us go sit here upon the church bench till 2, and then all to bed.
One word more, honest neighbors. I pray you watch about Signor Leonato's door. For the wedding being there tomorrow, there's a great coil tonight. Adieu. Be vigilant, I beseech you.
Conrade! Conrade! Conrade!
And I'm at thy elbow.
Oh. Conrade! Stand thee close. And like a true drunkard, I'll utter all to thee.
Some treason, masters, yet stand close.
Tonight I have earned of Don John 1,000 ducats.
Is it possible any villainy should be so dear?
Of course. Tonight I have wooed Margaret, the lady Hero's gentlewoman, by the name of Hero. She leads me out her mistress's bedroom window, bids me thousands of times good night. I tell this tale vilely. First, I should tell thee of how the prince, Claudio, and my master planted and placed and possessed by my master, Don John, saw afar off in the orchard this amiable encounter.
And thought they Margaret was hero?
Two of them did, the prince and Claudio. But the devil, my master, knew she was Margaret. And, partially by his lies, which first possessed them, and partially by the dark night, which did deceive them, but chiefly by my villainy, away went Claudio enraged, swore he would meet Hero as appointed at the temple the next morning, and there, and there, before the whole congregation, shame her with what he saw overnight, and send her away without a husband.
I charge you in the prince's name! Stand!
Call up the right master, constable. We have here recovered the most dangerous piece of lechery that was ever known in the Commonwealth.
Master.
Never speak. I charge you, let us obey you to go with us.
We should prove to be a goodly commodity being taken by these men's bills.
Commodity in question, I warrant you. Come, we'll obey you.
Ursula, go and wake my cousin Beatrice and desire her to rise.
I will, lady.
And bid her come hither.
Well.
By my troth, I think your other gown were better.
No, pray thee, good Meg, I'll wear this.
By my troth, it's not so good. And I warrant your cousin will say so.
My cousin's a fool, and thou art another. I'll wear none but this. Good morrow, cuz.
Oh, good morrow, sweet hero.
Why, how now? Do you speak in this sick tune?
I'm out of all other tune, methinks. 'Tis almost 5 o'clock. 'Tis about time you were ready. Oh, by my troth, I am exceedingly ill. Hi-ho!
For a hawk, a horse, or a husband.
These gloves the Count sent me, they're an excellent perfume.
I'm stuffed, cousin, I cannot smell.
Get you some of this Cardus Benedictus, lay it to your heart. It's the only thing for qualm.
There thou prickest her with a thistle.
Benedictus? Benedictus? You have some moral in this Benedictus!
Moral? No, by my troth, I have no moral meaning. I meant plain, holy thistle. You may think, perchance, that I think you're in love. Nay, by our lady, I'm not such a fool to list what I think, nor indeed I list not what I think I can. For indeed I cannot think, if I would think myself out of thinking, that you are in love, that you will be in love, or that you can be in love. Yet Benedick was such another, and now he has become a man. Benedick swore he would never marry, and yet now, in despite of his heart, he eats his meat without grudging. And how you may be converted, I know not. But methinks you look with your eyes as other women do.
What pace is this thy tongue keeps?
Not a false gallop.
Madam, withdraw. The prince, the count, Signor Benedick, Don John, all the gallants of the town have come to fetch you to church.
Help to dress me, good cuz, good Meg, good Ursula.
What it is that you want with me?
Marry, sir, we will have some confidence with you that discerns you nearly.
Brief, I pray you, for you see it's a busy time with me.
Marry, that it is, sir.
Yea, indeed it is, sir.
What is it, my good friends?
Good man Virgie, sir, speaks a little off the matter, and his wits are not as blunt as, God help, I would desire them to be, but, in faith, as honest as the skin between his brows.
I thank God that I am as honest as any man living.
Comparisons are odorous, neighbor Virgies.
Neighbors, you are tedious.
It pleases your worship to say so, but we are the poor duke's officers. But for my own part, if I were as tedious as a king, I could find it in my heart to bestow it all of your worship.
I would fain to know what you have to say.
Marry, sir, our watch tonight, accepting your worship's presence, has taken a couple as errant knaves as any in Messina.
A good man, sir, he will be talking. As they say, when the age is in, the wit is out. God help us, it's a world to see, and faith an honest soul as ever broke bread.
I must leave you.
One word, sir. Our watch, sir, hath indeed comprehended two auspicious persons, and we are this morning to have them examined before your worship.
Take examination upon yourself and bring it on to me. It's a busy time with me.
It shall be suffragance.
My lord, they stay for you to give your daughter away to her husband.
I'll wait upon them. I am ready.
Go, good partner. Go get you to Francis Seacole and bid him to bring his pen and inkhorn to the jail. We are now to examination these men.
And we must do it wisely.
We will spare you no wit. I warrant you.
Could my lord be married to this lady?
No.
To be married to your friar, you mean to marry her.
Lady, come hither, be married to this count.
I do.
If either of you have any inward impediment to why you shall not be conjoined, I charge you on your souls to utter it.
Know you any hero?
None, my lord.
You know any count?
I dare make this answer, none.
What men may do, what men dare do, what men daily do, not knowing what they do.
How now? Interjections? Why, some be of laughing is ha, ha.
Stand thee by, friar. Father, will you, with free and unconstrained soul, give me this maid, your daughter?
As freely, son, as God did give me her.
And what have I to give you back? Whose worth may counterpoise this rich and precious gift?
Nothing unless you render her again.
Sweet prince, you learn me noble thankfulness. Here, Leonato, take her back again. Give not this rotten orange to your friend. She's but the sign and semblance of your honor. See how like a maid she blushes here. Would you not swear, all you that see her, that she were but a maid by her exterior shows? But she's none. She knows the heat of a luxurious bed. Her blush is guiltiness, not modesty.
What do you mean, my lord?
Not to be married. Not to knit my soul to an improved wanton!
If you, in your own proof, have vanquished the resistance of her youth and made defeat of her maidhood...
I know what you would say. That if I had known her, that she did embrace me as a husband and so extenuate the forehand sin. But no, Leonato, I never tempted her with word too large. Rather, as a brother to a sister, showed her bashful sincerity and comely love.
And seemed I ever otherwise to you?
Out on thee! Seeming, I will write against it! You seem to me as Diana in her orb. As chaste as the bud ere it be blown. But you're more intemperate in your blood. Like Venus or one of those pampered animals that rage and savage sensuality.
Is my lord well that he does speak so wide?
Sweet prince, speak not why you.
What should I speak? I stand dishonored that I've gone about to link my dear friend to a common stale.
What man has talked with you yester hour, betwixt 12th and 1, out in your window? Now, if you're a maid, answer to this.
I talked with no man at that hour, my lord.
Why then are you no maiden? Leonato, I am sorry you must hear. Upon mine honor, myself, my brother, and this grieved count did see her, hear her, at that hour last night, talk with a ruffian at her chamber window, who hath indeed, most like a liberal villain, confessed the vile encounters they have had 1,000 times in secret.
Fie, they ought to be named, my lord, not to be spoke of. There is not chastity enough in language to, without offense, to utter them. Thus, my pretty lady, I am sorry for thy much misgovernment.
Oh, hero, what a hero hadst thou been, if half the outward graces have been placed in the thoughts and counsels of thy heart. But fare thee well, most foul, most fair, farewell.
Hath no man's dagger here a point for me?
Oh, hero, wherefore you sink down?
Come, let us go. These things come thus to light, smother her spirits up.
How doth the lady?
Dead, I think. Help, uncle, Benedick, uncle!
Oh, fate, take not thy heavy hand. Death is the fairest cover for a shame that may be wished for.
How now, sweet hero?
Have comfort, lady.
Dost thou look up?
Yes. Wherefore should she not?
Wherefore? Why doth not every earthly thing call shame upon her? Could she here deny the story that's imprinted in her blood? Do not live, hero. Do not open thine eyes. For I myself would, on rearward reproaches, strike at thy life. Grieved I had but one. Why had I one? One for that fugal nature's frame. Why had I but one? Why wast thou ever lovely in thine eyes?
Sir, be patient. I am attired in wonder. I know not what to say.
Oh, on my soul, my cousin is belied.
Lady, were you her bedfellow last night?
Confirmed.
Oh, truly not. Although I have this 12-month been her bedfellow every night until last.
Confirmed. Will the two princes lie and Claudio lie? That with his tears washed away her foulness? Hence from her, let her die!
Lady, what man is he you are accused of?
They know that do accuse me. I know none. If I know more of any man alive than that which maiden modesty doth warrant, let all my sins lack mercy. My father, prove you that any man with me conversed at hours unmeet, or that I yesternight maintained the change of words with any creature, refuse me, hate me, torture me to death.
There's some strange imprisonment in these princes. The two of them have the very bent of honor. If their wisdoms be misled in this, the practice of it lies in John the brother, whose soul toils in flames of villainy.
I know not what I think of this. These hands shall tear at her. But if they have disdained her honor, they shall well hear of it.
Pause a while, and let my counsel sway you in this case. Here, your daughter, the princess I left for dead. Let her be secretly kept inside, lest you publish that she is dead indeed.
What will become of this? What will this do?
When he hears that she has died upon his words, the idea of her life shall sweetly creep into the study of his imagination. And every lovely organ of her life shall come more appareled and more precious habit, more moving, delicate, and full of her life into the eye and prospect of his soul. That when she lives again, indeed, then he shall mourn,
And if he ever had a love interest in his heart for her, he wished he not so accused her. But he thought his accusation was true.
Signor Leonato, allow the friar to advise you in this. And though you know my inwardness and love are very much onto the prince and Claudio, yet, by my honor, I will deal in this.
Come, lady, die to live this wedding day. This wedding day is yet prolonged.
Lady Beatrice, have you wept all this while?
Yea, and I will weep a while longer.
I will not desire that.
You have no reason. I do it freely.
Surely. I do believe your fair cousin is wronged.
How much might the man deserve of me that would right her?
Is there any way to show such friendship?
A very even way, but no such friend.
May a man do it?
It is a man's office, but not yours.
Beatrice, I do love nothing in this world so well as you. Is not that strange?
It may well be possible to say that it's as strange as the thing I know not. It may well be possible to say that I love nothing so much as you. But believe me not. But I lie not. I confess nothing. Nor deny nothing. I'm sorry for my cousin.
Why, my sword, Beatrice, thou lovest me!
Do not swear and eat it.
I will swear by it that you love me, and I will make him eat it that says I love not you.
Will you not eat your word?
With no sauce that can be devised of it. I protest, I love thee.
Why then, God forgive me?
What offense, sweet Beatrice?
I was about to protest that I loved you. You have stayed me in a happy hour.
And do so with all thy heart.
I love you with so much in my heart that none is left to protest.
Come, bid me do anything for thee.
Kill Claudio.
Not for the wide world.
You kill me to deny it. Fare you well.
Tyree, Beatrice.
I am gone, though I am here. Nay, there was no love in you. In faith, I will go.
We'll be friends first.
You dare easier be friends with me than fight with mine enemy?
Is Claudio thine enemy?
Is he not approved in the height of a villain? He that has slandered, scorned, dishonored my fellow kinswoman. Oh, that I were a man. What?
He bare her in hand until they come together to take hands, and then with public accusation, uncovered slander, unmitigated rancor. Oh, that I were a man, I would eat his heart out in the marketplace.
Hear me, Beatrice.
Talk with a man out a window, a proper saying. Oh, sweet hero, she is undone. She is slandered, she is scorned. Princes and counties, a goodly testimony, a princely testimony, a goodly count, count confect, a sweet gallant surely.
Beatrice.
Oh. Men are turned into tongues and trim ones too. Oh, if I were a man, or I had any friend, would be a man for my sake. But manhood is melted into courtesies, valor into compliments. He is now only as valiant as Hercules that tells a lie and swears it. I cannot be a man with wishing. Therefore, I will die a woman with grieving.
Beatrice, by this hand, I love thee.
Use it for my love some other way than swearing by it.
Think you in your soul that Count Claudio hath wronged Hero?
Yea, as sure as I have a thought or a soul.
Enough. I am engaged. I will challenge him. I will kiss your hand. And so I leave you. By this hand, I will make Claudio a dear account. And as you hear of me, so too think of me. Go, be with your cousin. For I must say that she is dead. And so, farewell.
Is our whole assembly appeared? Ha. Let them come before me. What is your name, friend?
Borachio.
Pray, write down Borachio. Yours, sir?
My name is Conrade.
Masters, do you serve God?
Yea, sir.
We hope.
Write down they hope. They serve God. But write God first, for God defend and should go before such villains. Masters, it is proved already that you are little better than false knaves, and it would go so shortly to be thought so. How answer you for yourselves?
Marry, sir, we say we are none.
A marvelous witty fellow, I assure you, but I will go about with them. A word in your ear. Sir! I say to you, you are false knaves.
And I say to you, we are none.
Well, stand aside. They are both in a tale. Have you writ down that they are none?
Master Constable, you go not the way to examine. You must call forth the watch that are their accusers.
Yea, Mary, that's the effiest way. Let the watch come forth. Masters, I charge you, in the prince's name, accuse these men.
This man said, sir, that Don John, the prince's brother, was a villain.
Write down Prince John a villain. Why it is flat perjury to call the prince's brother villain.
Master Constable.
Pray thee, fellow, peace. I don't like thy look, I promise thee.
What heard you him say else?
Mary, that he had received 1,000 ducats from Don John for accusing the lady hero wrongfully.
Flat burglary as ever was committed.
Yea, by mass, that it is.
What else, fellow?
And that Count Claudio did mean, upon his words, to disgrace hero before the whole assembly and not marry her.
Oh, villain, thou wilt be condemned into everlasting redemption for this.
What else?
This is all.
And this is more, masters, than you can deny. Prince John is this morning secretly stolen away. Hero was in this manner accused, in this very manner refused, and upon the grief of this, suddenly died. Let these men be bound and brought to Leonato's. I will go before and show them their examination.
Come. Let them be opinioned.
Let them be in the hands of—
Off, coxcomb!
Gods, my life! Where's the secretary? Let her write down the prince's officer coxcomb. Come, find them, thou naughty varlet!
Wait, you are a dog. You are a dog.
Dost thou not suspect my place? Dost thou not suspect my ears? Oh, that she were here to write me down! A dog. But masters, remember that I am a dog. Though it may not be written down yet, not forget that I am a dog! And that will be filled with piety as shall be proved upon thee by good witness. I am a wise fellow, which is more, an officer, which is more, a householder, which is more, a pretty piece of flesh as any is in Messina. And one that knows the law, go to. And a rich fellow enough, go to, and one that have had losses and have 2 gowns and everything handsome about him? Oh, bring her away! Oh, that she were here to write me down a dog.
Now, senor, what news?
Good day, my lord.
We have been up and down to seek thee, for we are of high proof melancholy and would fain to have it beaten away. Wilt thou use thy wit?
It is in my scabbard. Shall I draw it?
Dost thou wear thy wit by thy side?
Never any did so, though very many have been beside their wit. I bid thee draw, as we minstrels do draw, to pleasure us.
As I am an honest man, he looks pale. Art thou sick or angry?
What courage, man! What though care killed a cat? Thou hast mettle in thee enough to kill care?
I shall speak a word in your ear. You are a villain. I jest not. I'll make it good with how you dare, with what you dare, and when you dare. Do me right, or I will protest your cowardice. You have killed a sweet lady, and her death shall fall heavy on you.
Well, let me hear from you.
Well, I will meet you, so that I may have good cheer.
Fare you well, boy. You know my mind. I'll leave you now to your gossip-like humor. My lord, for your many courtesies, I thank you. I must discontinue your company. Your brother has fled Messina. You have among you killed a sweet and innocent lady. And for my lord Blackbeard there, he and I shall meet. Until then, peace be with him.
He is in earnest.
In most profound earnest.
And hath challenged thee.
Most sincerely.
Did he not say my brother was fled?
Come you, sir. If justice cannot tame you, she shall never weigh more reasons in her balance. And you be a cursed hypocrite, you must be looked to.
How now? Two my brother's men bound, Borachio one?
Hearken after their offense, my lord.
Officers, what is their offense?
Moreover, sir, they have committed false reports. Secondarily, they have spoken unjust truths. They have also belied a lady. Sixth, and lastly, they have verified unjust truths. And to conclude, they are lying knaves.
This constable is too cunning to be understood. What is your offense?
Sweet prince, let me go no further into my answer. Hear me, and let this man kill me. I've betrayed even your very trust. What your wisdoms could not discover, these shallow fools have brought into light. Who in the night overheard me confessing to this man how Don John, your brother, incensed me to slander the lady hero. How you were brought before her chamber window the night before the wedding, but you saw me and Margaret there. How you disgraced her when you should marry her. My villainy they have on record. I should sooner see with my death than repeat for my shame. Sir, the lady here is dead upon mine and my master's false accusation. And briefly, I long for nothing but the reward of a villain.
Runs not this speech like iron through your blood?
I've drunk poison while he uttered it!
But did my brother set thee on this?
Yes, and paid me richly in the practice of it.
He is composed and framed of treachery, and fled he is upon this villainy.
Oh, hero. Now thy image doth appear in the rare semblance that it loved at first.
Come, bring the plaintiffs away. And masters, when time and place shall specify, remember, I'm a dog.
Which one of these is the villain? Let me see his eyes, that when I note another man like him, I should know avoid him. Which one of these is he?
If you would know your wronger, look on me.
Art thou the slave that hath, with thy breath, killed my innocent child?
Yes, even I alone.
No, not so, villain. Here stand a pair of honorable men, and a third that's fled that had a part in this. I thank thee for my daughter's death. Write it with thy noble and worthy deeds, if you bethink yourselves of it.
I know not how to pray your patience, but I must speak. Choose your revenge yourself. Impose to me to what penance your invention can lay upon my sin. But sinned I not but in mistaking.
And by my soul, nor I. And yet, to satisfy this good old man, I would bend under any heavy weight he would enjoin me to. I cannot bid you bid my daughter yet live. That were impossible. But I pray you both, possess the people here of Messina, how innocent a child she died. And if her love can harbor aught in sad invention, hang an epithet upon her tomb, and sing to her bones. Sing it tonight. Tomorrow, come to my house. And since you could not be my son-in-law, be yet my nephew. My brother hath a daughter, that's the mere copy of my innocent child that's dead. Come and marry her, and so dies my revenge.
I do embrace your conditions, and dispose for henceforth of poor Claudio.
Tonight, I take my leave. This naughty man shall be brought forth to Margaret, who I believe had a part in this, paid to it by your brother.
No, no. Margaret hath had no idea what part she played in this. She has always been kind and truthful and honest in everything I do know by her.
Moreover, sir, which is indeed not under black and white, this plaintiff, this offender, did indeed call me a dog. I beseech you, let that be remembered in her punishment.
I thank thee for thy troubles and thy cares.
I humbly give you leave to depart, and should a meeting be wished, God prohibit it. Come, neighbor.
Tonight I take my leave. Farewell. We will not fail.
Tonight, I'll mourn with Hero.
Thank you.
pray thee, sweet Mistress Margaret, deserve it well at my hand to help to the speech of Beatrice?
Will you then write me a sonnet in praise of my beauty?
Oh, in so high a style, Margaret, that no man living shall ever come over it. For in most comely true, thou deservest it.
To have no man come over me? Why, shall I always keep below stairs?
Thy wit is as quick as a greyhound's mouth. It catches.
And yours is like the fencer's foils. Witch it, but hurt not.
A most manly wit, Margaret. It will not hurt a woman. But pray thee, fetch Beatrice. I shall get thee the bucklers.
Give us the swords. We have bucklers of our own.
If you use them, Margaret, you'll have to put in a pike with a vice. And they are dangerous weapons for maids.
Well, I will fetch Beatrice to you, whom I think hath legs.
And therefore, will come. The God of love that sits above and knows me and knows me. How pitiful I deserve. I am mean in singing, but in loving. Leonard, the good swimmer, Troilus, the first employer of panderers, why, they were never so turned over and over in love as my poor self. Mary, I cannot find it in rhyme, I've tried. I can find no rhyme for lady, but baby, an innocent rhyme. For scorn, horn, a hard rhyme. For school, fool, a babbling rhyme. Very ominous endings. No, I was not born under a rhyming planet. Nor can I woo in festival terms. Oh, fair Beatrice, wouldst thou come when I call thee?
Yea, senor, and depart when thou bid me.
Oh, but stay till then.
Then is spoken. Fare you well.
Wait.
But ere I go, let me go with that which I came, knowing what has passed between you and Claudio.
Only foul words, and thereupon I shall kiss thee.
Foul words is but foul wind, and foul wind is but foul breath is noisome, therefore I will depart unkissed.
Thou hast frightened the word out of his right sense, so forcible is thy wit. But I must tell thee plainly. Claudio undergoes my challenge. And either I shall soon hear from him, or I shall subscribe to him a coward. And pray thee, of which of my bad parts didst thou first fall in love with?
Why, for them all together, which did maintain so politic a state of evil that they did not allow any good to intermingle with them. But for which of my good parts did you first suffer love for me?
Suffer love? A good epithet. For I do suffer love, indeed, for I love you against my will.
In spite of your heart? Alas, poor heart. If you spite it for my sake, I will spite it for yours. I cannot love that which my friend hates.
Thou and I are too wise to woo peaceably. And tell me, how doth your cousin?
Very ill.
And how do you?
Very ill, too.
Go. Serve God, love me, and mend.
Madam! You must come to your uncle. It is proved. My lady hero hath been falsely accused, the prince and Claudio mightily abused, and Don John, the author of it all, is fled and gone. Will you come presently?
Will you go hear this news, senor?
I will live in thy heart, die in thy lap, and be buried in thy eyes. And moreover, I shall go with thee to thy uncle's.
Did I not tell you that she was innocent?
So are the prince and Claudio, upon there that you've heard debated. Although Margaret was in some fault for this, although against her will, in true course of all question.
Well, I am glad all things sort so well.
Friar, I must entreat your pains, I think.
To do what, senor?
To bind me, or undo me. One of them. Senor Leonato. Truth is, good sir, your niece doth requite me with an eye of favor.
That I my daughter lent her, 'tis most true.
And I, with an eye of favor, requite her.
And I do believe you had that for me and the prince and Claudio, but what's your will?
Your answer, sir, is enigmatical. But for my will, my will is your goodwill. May stand with ours this day and be conjoined in a state of honorable in a state of honorable marriage. in a state of honorable marriage. Which, friar, I will desire your help.
It is with my liking.
And to my help. Because of Prince Claudio.
Good morrow to this fair assembly.
Good morrow, Prince. Good morrow, Claudio. Are you here yet determined to marry my brother's daughter?
I will hold my mind.
Bring her forth. Here's the friars ready.
Which is the lady I must seize upon?
This is she. I do give her you.
Why then, she's mine. Sweet, let me see your face.
No. Not till you take her hand and swear before this friar to marry her. Good.
Lady, give me your hand, and before this friar, I am your husband, if thou likest of me.
And when I lived, I was your other wife. And when you loved, you were my other husband.
Another hero!
Nothing certainer. One died defiled, but I do live. And surely as I live, I am a maid.
The former hero? The hero that is dead?
She was dead yet while our slander lived.
Huh.
Fair hero's death. Meantime, what wonder seems so familiar? With the chapel, let us presently.
Soft and fair friar. And which is Beatrice?
I answer to that name. What is your will?
Do not you love me?
Why, no, no more than reason.
Why, then, your uncle, the prince, and Claudio were deceived. They swore you did.
Do you not love me?
Troth, no. No more than reason.
Why, then, my cousin, Margaret, and Ursula were much deceived, for they did swear you did.
They said you were almost sick for me.
They said you were well nigh dead for me.
'Tis no such matter. Then, do not you love me?
Why, no more than friendly recompense.
Come, cousin, I'm certain you'd love the gentleman.
Well, I'll be sworn upon that he loves her. For here is a paper written in his own hand, a halting sonnet of his own pure brain, fashioned to Beatrice.
And here's another, writ in my cousin's hand, stolen from her pocket, containing her affection unto Benedick.
A miracle. Here's our hands against our hearts. Come, I shall take thee. But by this light, I take thee for pity.
I would not deny you, but upon this great day, I yield upon much persuasion, and partly to save your life, for I was told you were in a consumption.
Peace. I will stop your mouth.
How dost thou, Benedick, the married man?
I'll tell thee what, Prince. College of wit crackers cannot flout me out of my happiness.
dost thou think I care for a satire and epigram? No. If a man shall be beaten with brains, he shall wear nothing handsome about him. In brief, since I do propose to marry, I shall hear nothing that the world shall propose against it. And therefore, never flout me for anything that I have said against it. For man is a giddy thing, and this is my conclusion. Claudio, for thy part I did think to have beaten thee, but in that thou art to be my kinsman. Go, live unbruised, and love my cousin.
I would have hoped thou wouldst have denied, Beatrice, that I might have cudgeled thee out of thy single life to make thee a double dealer, which out of question thou wilt be, if my cousin do not look exceedingly narrow to thee.
Come, come, we are friends. Let's have a dance ere we are married, so may we may lighten our hearts and our wives' heels.
We'll have dancing afterward.
First of my word. Therefore, play music.
My lord, your brother has escaped and is brought with armed men back to Messina.
Think not of him till tomorrow. I shall devise brave punishments for him. Prince, thou look sad. Get thee a wife. Strike up, pipers!